So I'm Paul Brewster, Senior Planner, Thurston Regional Planning Council. I am the lead for our region's hazards mitigation plan update. And so on today's agenda, I'm going to give you, started off with an overview of where we're at with the risk assessment, as there's some ongoing work with that. Casey has prepared hazard maps for your annexes to support your annexes. We'll give you a little overview of that and where you can access them and view them. And Casey's going to demonstrate a draft online hazard mapping tool that we've put together to assist you with developing your risk assessment and mitigation strategy. Then I'm going to just kind of introduce countywide mitigation initiatives and what is an appropriate regional mitigation strategy, and hopefully have some discussion about the types of what you think are important actions we include in our plan that are more of a multi-jurisdiction effort than just what you have in your annex as your individual effort. And then I'll give you an overview of what's coming down the road with next steps in the hazard mitigation plan. And so first off, risk assessment update. So last month, Tetra Tech came and offered an overview of the loss matrices, what we call the phase one risk assessment, which was a combination of hazard exposure analysis and modeling estimates from HAZUS, which is a GIS tool to estimate losses based on certain hazard scenarios. So if you recall, for flood, we did a 50, 100, 500-year flood scenarios. We did dam inundation failure for the Nisqually Hydroelectric Project and the Skookumchuck Dam. For earthquake, we did Cascadia, Nino, Nisqually, and Seattle Fault. And then we also did exposure analysis for the whole range of everything else. So everything from Lahar inundation to landslide hazards, sea level rise. So they are still working, and Tetra Tech informed me last week that we should receive the critical facilities phase two risk assessment results, which will inform, this is really important for special purpose districts because this informs which of your facilities are exposed to hazards and what types of impacts they might expect to receive. So for our March meeting, Tetra Tech is going to come provide an overview of the results from that data, and we'll try to get that data sent out to you ahead of time. So that's it. Do I have it? That's kind of the update. We expect to send out to you probably later next week. We're expecting the critical infrastructure loss data March 6th. So later next week, we expect to get that out to you for your review so that you'll have some time to preview it prior to our meeting on March 27th. So any questions about the risk assessment?
Paul, Chief Smith here from West Thurston. I just wanted to compliment you on the presentation you had at the County Chiefs meeting last week. And I think you provided some of this data. Do you plan on presenting any of that data here in this meeting here, or will you be sharing that by email? It was a PowerPoint presentation.
Yes, thanks, Robbie. I shared that information with Chief Brooks, so I was expecting that to be sent out to all of the other fire chiefs, but I'll follow up with Chief Brooks to make sure that gets sent out. Chief Smith is referring to last week, I presented to the Association of Thurston County Fire Chiefs information about the wildland fire risk, specifically because I was trying to solicit stakeholders from the fire service to help provide feedback on that risk assessment. So this is information you already received that was part of the loss matrices. but I went to the fire chiefs because developing a wildland urban interface map and identifying high hazard areas for Thurston County has been a mitigation, a countywide mitigation initiative that was to be led by the fire chiefs. And so I'm trying to maintain that nexus of their expertise and helping our planning process better understand wildland fire risks. So I have a small group of fire chiefs who volunteered to assist in taking a little deeper dive on that data. But Chief Smith, I was not planning to present what I shared at the Fire Chiefs Association with this work group, because that will be, what I'd prefer to do is have that information summarized in the wildland fire hazard profile for this group to respond to based on the chief's input.
Okay, fair enough. Thank you, Paul.
Yep. Any other questions on the risk assessment? Okay, let's jump into talking about proofing the hazard maps. And I'm just going to give me a second here to pull up a presentation to share with you. So one of the requirements in hazard mitigation planning for FEMA is that in your risk assessment that you describe the location of hazards in your community. And that can be done through maps, it can be done through description. I encourage you to do both, because both are helpful. So Casey, in the last several weeks, has started putting together hazard maps for all of the plan partners. So these will be maps that will go into your annex that will support both your risk assessment as well as your mitigation strategy. This is really kind of your public-facing toolkit to communicate where potential there are hazard risks in your communities. And so these are done by jurisdiction, and the number of maps that your jurisdiction receives will depend upon the hazards that we have mapped for your areas. So for example, western part of Thurston County, city of Yelm, Nisqually, Indian Reservation, those areas would be impacted by a volcanic lahar from Mount Rainier, but West Thurston Fire Authority, not so much. So West Thurston would not have a lahar hazard map. But what we have are hazard maps that encompass these eight areas. So dam failure, for earthquake, we have liquefaction. You won't have these in your annex unless you want to add them, but in our earthquake hazard profile, we will also have shake maps from the hazardous earthquake scenarios that we do that really shows the radiation of peak ground acceleration. We'll have flood maps. They're broken out by delineated for 50, 100, 500 year floods plus high groundwater areas. Landslide hazards, which consist of both the slopes that are over 40% and DNR's known landslide hazard areas and historic landslides. We have a sea level rise scenario that principally only affects city of Olympia and unincorporated Thurston County. Might includes also some other fire districts and school districts in there. Tsunami again, similar, wouldn't be impacting West Thurston or Yelm for that matter. And then of course volcanic lahar and wildfire, which is countywide. So here's just a sample of the maps. This is West Thurston Regional Fire Authority, and this is a map of the wildland urban interface area. And so this template or format is common across all of the plan partners. So we've come up with a specific design that Casey put together. It shows the hazard area, it shows jurisdictional boundaries, major transportation facilities. And then if you have critical facilities, in this case, it would be fire districts, we're displaying those. So we're when we're asking for feedback, we're really not looking for feedback on the hazard layers and how they're presented, unless, of course, you can offer us insights as to what would maybe make them more visual or easier to read for people, say, who maybe have some visual impairments, like if it's a color problem or something like that. That type of accessibility feedback is always useful. But what we're really looking for is feedback from you, and is the information accurate? Do we have the right title shown for your jurisdiction? If we're displaying critical facilities, and we do on this first round of maps, we're displaying critical facilities, we want to know which ones are okay to show and which ones you prefer we take off because you don't want to share that information to the general public for security reasons. And then examples of what would be useful facilities to show that we do categorize as critical would be like location of schools, location of fire stations, perhaps Thurston PUD, you want some of your water systems shown. So if that's the case, let us confirm with us what you want us to show, and please let us know what you want us to omit from the map. And then it would be helpful as to how you want us to label that. So we've already talked to, for example, the fire chiefs that are partners to the plan, and they want us to give the numeric station identifier. So we're going to show those on the map. And then for special purpose districts, you know, your mission and the type of facilities you manage varies quite a bit from the counties and cities. So if there's other thematic data that you want us to display, like for example, intercity transit, we're showing transit routes and I think maybe major transit stations. So if you have certain information like that, that would be helpful. Please let us know. So Casey has put these maps all online. We've created a Box account. Here's the link for the Box account. Casey will be sending this out with meeting notes so that you can access it. You shouldn't need a password, but if you do run into problems accessing this Box account, let us know. I'm just going to give you a demo now of what that Box account looks like so you can navigate to your maps and just get a quick view of what you can expect when you get there in your browser. So bear with me. Is that showing up? Are you all seeing my web browser? Okay.
Yes.
So we'll send you the link, paste that into your web browser. You'll see that there's several directories, subdirectories in here. These are other sources of information that you might find useful, but today what we're pointing to you is this maps directory. And so when you go there, it's conveniently organized by name of your jurisdiction. You just have to click on those. For example, City of Yelm, and then there's links to all of your maps. And you can just, you know, for example, right click on a title to download that and save that locally. You can then email it and share it with your teammates. I encourage you to huddle with your maps, record any feedback, and send that information to Casey. And in our meeting notes, we'll summarize, you know, kind of again, what type of general information that we're looking for from you. So any questions on the hazard maps? And if you're wanting to know what you do with these, if you go to trpc.org/hazards, where our current 2017 plan is located. You can click on that, look at the jurisdiction annex documents, and you'll see that the annex maps are typically embedded in the risk assessment pertaining to each hazard in the annex document. Okay, so next up, Casey is gonna give you an overview of the online map, hazard map that she compiled. Go ahead, Casey.
Okay, thank you. So yeah, just one more comment on that box link. Just to clarify, if you don't have maps, it's probably because you didn't indicate to us that you plan to produce a plan annex. So we only produce maps for agencies that indicated they will be creating an annex. Feel free to get in touch if you don't find maps for your agency. And then let me just share my screen now. Before we head over to the online mapping resource, just one more thing I wanted to share about this box drive is we do have all the 2017 plan documents in here. So the full plan is at the bottom, and then all of the adopted annexes are here too. So you don't have to head to TRPC's website. Okay, another thing you'll find in this box drive is the link to our online map. So as you may have noticed from the just quick shot you got into the static annex maps, it's pretty hard to use these as a planning tool at the scale that they're at. It's much easier to be able to zoom in and mess around with it, turn layers on and off. So that's why we created this online mapping resource. So if you click this link, and I'll send out the link in the email with the notes as well, you will come to this webpage and you get a splash screen. So folks who are familiar with ArcGIS web maps, this may look very familiar to you, but this is just a little screen that you'll hit with some instructions about how to use the map. It's not exactly user-friendly. I had to use some workarounds to get the functionality that we wanted. And again, you know, if you're struggling to use this tool, just give me a call or shoot me an email and we can go through it together. So hopping right in, one thing to note about this tool is that we are using this as an internal planning tool. We're encouraging folks not to share this with the public because it does have all the critical facilities information on it. This is more just for your own review as you are drafting your annex risk assessments. So I'm not gonna read all these instructions. I'll just kind of navigate and go through, but these instructions just tell you these little buttons, this is what they do. So we can click through this screen and then you get the home page for the map. The default is just showing the critical facilities and the county outline. We don't have any hazard layers or agency boundaries at this time. So the first thing you may want to do is you can click this button with the little squares and you can change your base map. I do this a lot. I don't know, personal preference, but you have access to a few different ones in here. The next thing you may want to do is filter your critical facilities to just the facilities for your agency. So if you go to this little filter icon, and this meeting's also being recorded, so you can kind of go back to this demo. If you hit this little filter icon, you get this filter menu, and you can narrow down the critical facilities to just your agency. So unfortunately, you can only click one agency at a time. So I know with fire districts in particular, you may be looking at two different districts' assets. You'll just have to do that separately. But let's just do, we'll do Town of Bucota. So if you click your agency and then you toggle it on, that then goes to just the facilities for the agency that you are looking at. So that's a good first step. And then next we have these two folder icons. One of them is going to let you toggle on and off the layers for different jurisdictions. And the other one is going to let you toggle on and off different hazard layers. So this first folder icon, you click on it, and here we have the agency boundaries in two different places. So the reason for this is different hazards, just how they're displayed. Sometimes it's easier to see an outline of your jurisdiction's boundaries, and sometimes it's easier to see kind of a colored polygon for your agency. So there's a couple different options here, and if you want to go back to the county at a whole that extent, you can just click this home button to go back to the default extent. But let's say I guess I'm looking at the town of Bucota. So since it's a city, county, town, I'm going to be looking at this jurisdiction boundaries. If I turn that on, that shows me all the jurisdiction boundaries. And with any layer on this map, if you click it, it'll give you a little pop-up just identifying what it is. So we've got urban growth areas marked differently. And again, what I'm talking about with colors versus outlines, if I wanted to go up here, I can see just the outlines of the jurisdictions. I can still click and it'll tell me what I'm looking at. That's that. And so we have a layer for college campuses. This would be St. Martin's, Evergreen State, and SPSCC. We've got the fire districts. This is the taxing districts, not the response districts. And some of these, so this is based off the way geodata, Thurston County geodata, has your district layers in their maps. So even though West Thurston encompasses kind of two separate taxing districts, I guess, you'll want to look at two polygons. Okay, and then we have inner city transit, and then the school districts as well. So we've got our jurisdictions, we can turn those on and off. Now let's head to that second folder to see all the hazard layers. So there's a different kind of little area for each hazard. And we're pretty limited on how you can display these. So my suggestion to keep things clear is you can minimize these different groups of layers by clicking on it. So if I want to look at, let's see, I know landslide has multiple layers. I can shrink all the other ones and then I can easily see, okay, these are my two landslide hazard exposure areas. So you can turn them on. And they do appear in this legend on the left, but they appear at the bottom, so you may have to scroll. You can also hit this little arrow and that'll show you how they are shown on the map. And then from here, you can zoom in and you can see if the hazard areas overlap with your critical facilities. You can click on things to, again, remind yourself what that layer is. Can also click on critical facilities to remind yourself what that facility is and go from there. So the reason we had these outlines and colors is when you look at something like the wildfire layer, this is just every spot on the map shows something. And so maybe for this, you'd want to turn on your jurisdiction boundary outline, and that way you can easily see, okay, here's where the interface is, here's where the intermix is, and so on, and you can click that. When you click a space on the map, if there are multiple layers where you click, so like with wildfire, I'm clicking in Bucota's boundary, but I'm also clicking on this orange wildfire layer. You can hit this area arrow to see the different different things that are in the area that you clicked. So we're going a bit quickly, but this is pretty much it. I mean, you can use these two folder icons to see what layers you have and toggle them on and off. Again, this filter is how you filter down the critical facilities. And if you want to go back to seeing everyone's critical facilities, you can just toggle that off and they all come back. And then to see the instructions, kind of just what I went over, you can hit this I button. And this is the same information that popped up on the splash screen when you opened the map. And my email's right at the bottom if you have questions. The last button is there is this share. Again, not encouraging you to share it with the public, but you can copy this link and send it out to your planning team. So that is the tool. Does anybody have questions at this point or things you'd like to see again?
So just jump on and I'll add the data that we can, TRPC can account for is the critical facilities data because that is data that we collected from you. And emphasize again that please, the distribution of this link for this map is for internal distribution only. We just advise that you limit for the time being. who outside your team can view this data, because it because of the critical facilities, we want to limit its distribution. Data that we can't really account for is that base map layer data that belongs to ESRI, that is the vendor of the software for the online map tool. This is their data. So as you're viewing the base layer, like Casey, when she was zoomed into Bucota, you start to see building footprints. So we at TRPC can't vouch for those building footprints. But if you turn on that aerial photo layer with the building footprints, just starting using a combination of data, you can get a sense of what you think is really on the ground. So where that can be useful, that, for example, that topographic map with the flood layers is gives you at least a sense of, okay, how many structures do you see in that area that may be in a floodplain? And you can compare that to the 50, 100, 500 year in high groundwater flood loss estimation matrix that Tetra Tech provided. So this is all just a visual tool to augment that loss matrices data that we provided you, as well as your jurisdiction hazard maps, to just give you a better picture of the location and extent of these hazards in our communities. And then,
thanks, Paul.
Yeah, one more thing. The critical facilities layer right now is very limited in the type of attributes. Like when Casey clicked on one of the facility dots, it just kind of gives you the name of what that facility is. Well, I can't make any promises. What we're hoping is when we get this critical facilities data back from Tetra Tech after it's been processed for the risk assessment and loss estimation, it's conceivable that we can replace this file with attribute data that describes what the potential hazard impacts are to those facilities. So as you click on it, you could see other types of information. We'll give you an update on whether we can actually perform that as I described.
One more thing I did want to share. If you really want to get technical with it and play around with it, one thing you can do with the layers, so again, these two folder icons are where you can see your layers and toggle them on and off. All the layers have these three dots at the right, on the right, and if you click those, you have two options. You can zoom to the layer. So find a better example. If we wanted to do, let's say, dam failure, then is quality dam failure, we can hit zoom to, and it puts that layer right in the middle and zooms out to see the entire extent. So that's one option you have. The other option you have is you can, on your own, that whole menu. On your own, you can adjust the transparency of all the features. So if I wanted to make this darker, I would go this way and so on. So you've got that functionality with the jurisdictions as well. If you wanted to, you know, easier see the base map or the layers underneath, you can adjust that yourself. Okay. That's all I had.
Thanks, Casey. So let's just see, thumbs up. Is this tool gonna be helpful to you in looking at your hazards and if this will work? I would say if special purpose districts, cities, counties, if there's additional data layers that you have that you might want us to add to this map, you can talk to Casey and see if that's something we might be able to pull from our library, or if you have it in GIS, you can share that with us. But yeah, thanks to Casey for making this happen. This is a nice tool that I'm hoping will help you with your annex development. Okay, next up, let's talk about regional mitigation actions and the countywide mitigation actions. So I'm pull up my next presentation here. Okay, so we're really talking about, we're going to start talking about actions. These are recommendations that we would include in the plan. And today we're really focusing on our core plan or our basic plan. This is the portion of the document that reflects our entire planning area. And since our region has first developed a mitigation plan back in 2003 through 2017, we've identified these countywide mitigation initiatives. And these are actions that involve multiple leads, or if it's just one lead, multiple partners. But the idea is that these actions would have a positive impact to reduce risks across most or a significant portion of Thurston County, our overall planning area. If it's not an action that's directly reducing a risk, it's an action that's identifying data or resources that can better inform mitigation actions or even response. I think the best way to describe it is these are actions that really benefit multiple communities. Even if they're not planned partners that are developing an annex, these are actions that overall improve our community resilience. And then lastly, the ones that we're identifying here are should be actions that are achievable. They should be practical to implement and be fairly cost effective. So we have 12 of these actions in our 2017 plan. And they were prioritized. They were prioritized by the Hazard Mitigation Planning Workgroup back in 2017 when we last updated the plan. That prioritization process was done through both an initial self-paced online survey where the representatives like yourself just ranked them from 1 being highest through 12 being lowest. We tallied those results, and then at a hazard mitigation work group meeting, we discussed through, hey, why did you prioritize them this way? And then we went through like, I think 2 or 3 iterations to sort out those areas of disagreement as to which mitigations should be ranked higher than others. So it wasn't a very scientific method. It was just really, hey, we as the Hazard Mitigation Workgroup members thought these actions would be most beneficial, hence their prioritization. The ID number is kind of a code. CW is countywide. That's what that prefix is there. MH refers to multi-hazard, meaning it would be an action that would help reduce risks for multiple hazards. So like if you look at priority number 4, it's countywide FH, that would be flood hazard. And then the number is just that ID, that first flood hazard or that first time that action was identified in a plan and assigned that unique ID number. So that's the thinking that went behind the convention for the identification number. And then we have categories of hazards. So there are several, everything from how do we reduce the effects of hazard? That's hazard damage reduction. If it's more of a emergency management response type operational objective that might not necessarily be tied directly to mitigation, but it offers some risk reduction, those are hazard preparedness. If it's like a community engagement, outreach, public education, it's categorized as public information. I think you start to get the picture. Like data collection and mapping, that's just what that is. It's information that helps inform our mitigation planning as well as developing our mitigation strategy. So we have 12. I just kind of quickly want to go through these because if you haven't read the 2017 plan, you may not be familiar with them. But the point here today is to really introduce these. to introduce the concept of the countywide mitigation initiatives, to start to have a discussion about, should we keep these in the plan? What work has been done on these to date? Like, is it time to take it out? Have we checked the box on it? Is this action no longer applicable? Should we be replacing it? So today, this is really just an opportunity to preview these, to get a sense of what is in these countywide initiatives. So I'd be asking you, as you're looking through these, perhaps you have an idea in mind. So as I'm going through these, you might want to be thinking, what's missing here? What should we be considering adding to this plan update? So this first one, create a lifeline transportation route, GIS map for the Thurston region, integrate the data into Thurston County Emergency Operations Plan and other planning needs. The whole point of this one is to say, what are our key routes? And where are there areas that we have vulnerabilities, and how can we get these mapped into the system? And if we have a major catastrophic event like an earthquake, our public works engineers, planners can immediately get into an assessment and go out and assess those parts of the network. So a little more response oriented, but the idea is to start getting this into some GIS with some means to inform decision-making at the jurisdiction level. Hazard preparedness, strengthening interjurisdictional asset management capabilities. This is really recognizing that all of our partners have certain apparatuses, large public works equipment, and resources that could be shared depending upon how the community is impacted. So having some inventory of what assets are available, who owns it, what its capabilities are, and documenting that was the idea behind this, that it's basically like an asset library. Developing and maintaining a hazards mitigation plan, public outreach strategy. I would say we do a good job when we're updating the plan, but overall there's not a lot of public outreach that continues on around hazard mitigation at a countywide level in the interim years. So the concept behind this is to, how do we continue broadcasting the message, informing community members and our policymakers that this work is ongoing? It's not just something we do every 5 years, but that this is something that our plan partners are regularly working on. Number four is developing emergency evacuation routes for potential catastrophic dam failure. This could also pertain to Lahar. Developing a disaster debris management strategy. This is just how do jurisdictions coordinate debris collection, removal, proper disposal following a major disaster, whether that's natural debris or structural debris or hazardous materials. This is one we just talked about earlier today. Map the region's high-risk wildland urban interface communities. This has been in our plan since the second edition. It identified the Association of Fire Chiefs as the lead. Fortunately, Washington State Department of Natural Resources performed this task for our plan. So we do have a WUI map for the interface and intermix areas identified. Does that satisfy our need? Does this get us closer to understanding where our high risk wildland fire hazard areas in the community are located? Number seven, inventorying essential facilities and assets to support hazard mitigation planning and emergency management. Our community grows. We get new fire stations popping up, new water systems come online, new schools built. How well do we do at coordinating, tracking, and sharing this information and maintaining it and keeping it updated so that it's readily available, up to date, in the hands of emergency managers when the information is needed? We scrambled to kind of get some of this information for our plan update. So the thinking behind this is, this just needs to be an ongoing effort. And Thurston County Emergency Management was identified as the lead to take the initiative to maintain this. Number eight is about, I would say it's not just earthquake modeling, it's also flood modeling, but this is how can we build in-house capabilities in our communities, like for example, Thurston Geodata or Thurston Emergency Management, to be able to do this hazardous modeling for disaster events so that we can do our own forecasts and estimations of disaster losses to better inform plans and response strategies. Inventorying and assessing sheltering facilities. With extreme heat events, we have cooling shelters. During extreme cold events, warming shelters. We have air quality issues. The idea here is those entities that have the resources and the capacity to have sheltering facilities, what are the characteristics of those facilities? What is their occupancy? What types of amenities or services do they have on hand? Maybe what might the staffing needs be based on the certain capacity of the shelter? Just trying to identify for that facility, what is a good fit for the disaster or the response need at hand, and having that information centralized and available to emergency managers. Mapping transportation, I'm on number 10, mapping transportation infrastructure that is subject to frequent flooding or is prone to landslide hazards. This is again, similar to number one, but just a general awareness. We know, we have a good sense of where our hazard areas are, but do we know, can we readily look that up in some database or system or map that flags areas that are prone to these so that personnel can go out and assess situations after incidents occur? Or per capital facilities planning, identify projects that stabilize slopes, elevate roads, replace culverts, et cetera, to reduce the number of closures that occur on those facilities. Number 11, develop and adopt a climate adaptation plan. You'll notice this one and number six are in bold because these are actions that were completed since the plan has been adopted. The climate adaptation plan was developed and approved by TRPC in 2018, but that there's no, unlike a hazard mitigation plan, there's no FEMA mandate to update these plans on any given interval. There's a lot of useful information in the climate adaptation plan. Should that plan be updated, or should hazard mitigation planning start to carry some of the weight and do more of that climate adaptation planning? It might be more of the latter as FEMA's revised policy guidance that takes effect in April requires that jurisdictions account for the effects of climate change on hazards that impact communities. And in my next slide, I'll kind of walk through what some of those adaptation actions are that maybe we want to walk over into the mitigation plan. And then lastly, strengthen the capabilities to establish and maintain situational awareness of health and medical system and resource coordination during an emergency. That's a real mouthful, but I think following COVID-19, there's probably a lot of lessons learned that could be applied to and to evaluate this initiative to determine if there's ESF6 or ESF8 functions that need to be accounted for in hazard mitigation planning. And so these initiatives, I'm going to stop sharing here for a second and pull up another screen. The initiatives in the plan, they're identified in the strategy and recommendation section of the document. So this is chapter two. It includes both the goals and policies of the mitigation plan, as well as the recommendations. But for each of these 12 actions, there's a one-page summary that provides the rationale or a problem statement for the initiative. How it ties in to the mitigation plan's goals and policies. It identifies the leads. If there's an estimated cost known, that's put in the time period. And for all of these initiatives, the time period was identified from the last 5 years that the plan was in effect. And then information about where the action originated from. And then lastly, perhaps the most useful information is the initiative and implementation status. So as part of our plan update, we need to report on the status of any actions that have been taken with the recommended initiatives in the plan. So yep, one pager for each of these. So our charge will be to go through these, not today, but we're gonna go through these and decide which continue to carry forward, and working with the agencies that were identified as the lead to get a status update on how far along they are. And if we decide we're gonna take it out, we just need to provide an explanation for why that initiative is no longer useful or needed in the plan. So I'm gonna pause there and just see if there's any questions about these 12 initiatives in the plan. I see Sherry said in chat that number 2 should be maintained as an ongoing initiative. So that's the strengthen interjurisdictional asset management. Is that what you're referring to, Sherry?
I was actually referring to number 3.
Okay. Hazards mitigation public outreach strategy.
Because that's going to be a continuation each time.
It will be.
Throughout the life cycle of the planning process.
And so feedback like that, like what would be something we'd want to reformat in the plan, like as Sherry's saying, maybe these get taken out as new or check the box and you're done, and separate them out as ongoing. Like we just always need to have these in the mitigation as a general goal. Is that what you're getting at, Sherry?
Absolutely. Yeah, because each year, like for instance, this year when we began the process, you know, we did a survey. You know, so all the different methods that we use to get the word out about the plan. So I think it's going to kind of be a continual process.
And we could think of how we break out the continuing initiatives or efforts as just sort of guiding principles or things we need to always be doing. Brandon, I see you have your hand up.
Yes. So two questions. First, is there a recommended or reasonable limit to the amount of region-wide or regional initiatives? I see 12, but I mean, just so everyone can kind of keep in their mind, I mean, is like 50 too much or like 20? I guess kind of what's the sweet spot for like the region-wide mitigation initiatives? Or is there just really no limits just based on kind of what's needed?
There's no federal requirement. In fact, there's no federal requirement that we even do these regional countywide initiatives. This was something that plan partners decided to do. I would say that the number should be driven by what do you see as the priorities given the information you have about risks to our communities that you want to try to achieve in the next 5 years and beyond, and what's practical to implement. Because you can make this pie in the sky and have an unlimited number of initiatives, but if nobody has the resources or the wherewithal to get to them, should you have it in the plan?
Gotcha. So I guess a reasonable thing to maybe consider is if the initiative you're thinking of including or proposing is actually going to be implemented or started in the next 5 years, is that kind of
it? It could be 5 years, but it could be beyond. You're always supposed to be doing hazard mitigation, and there might be something you want to memorialize in a plan, knowing that you can't get around to it. But knowing that when you get to the next 5-year update, you think it's important enough that you got to revisit it and keep it in there.
Gotcha. Thanks. And then my second question is So I've already been thinking up, I guess, several ideas. I'm just going through this process and looking at the region-wide initiative. So if we have sort of an idea for an initiative or something we'd want to do for mitigation, but it closely relates to a currently existing region-wide initiative, would we still create it as its own separate initiative or just sort of try and nest it in the region-wide initiative? And I'll use an example currently. So Sherry talked about the public outreach for hazard mitigation piece. And one of the project ideas or initiatives I was thinking of is creating a public interfacing story map similar to the planning tool Casey provided, obviously filtering out those things the public probably doesn't need to see or digest. But creating sort of a web story map instead that sort of achieves the a member of the public being able to look up their property and kind of identify the hazards around their parcel and property and stuff like that. Kind of similar to what the county does for like land use planning with geodata.
You could go both ways. If it's something very specific that you think you have the budget to do, and can schedule it into a work program, there's value in calling it out on its own. But another option is you could nest it in an existing initiative to just try to make the number of initiatives you have more manageable. And so, for example, on that number 3, develop and maintain a hazards mitigation public outreach strategy, you could say something to the effect of this strategy would consist of the following types of actions. And then you could list a bullet of a online GIS story map and, you know, list several other types of things you would like to do that are related to that.
Okay, cool.
Yep. It's sort of all just what this work group thinks is a reasonable approach. And also who is identified as the lead on the initiative. So if it's Thurston County Emergency Management is the lead and you want to put those things in, a lot of people will say, sounds great, go for it. So, okay, so let's move on here. I'm going to reshare my screen. So go to chapter 2 of the plan online. Start looking through these, becoming familiar with them. The next thing I want to talk about is a climate adaptation plan. And Brandon, this kind of gets to what you were asking about the number of initiatives and actions that you have. And I think this climate adaptation plan is a good example of illustrating where you can identify numerous actions, but the challenge becomes how does a lead develop the capacity, the knowledge, and gain the resources to implement them? And so I think keeping it manageable is really important. So for example, the Thurston Climate Adaptation Plan, this was funded by I believe it was a NOAA grant. TRPC applied for the funding. The project focused, based on the grant, watersheds that drained into the Puget Sound. And this plan used the University of Washington Climate Impacts Group vulnerability assessment for the effects of climate change on Puget Sound region in Washington State, and identified 91 adaptation actions. And in the recommendations section of this plan, it categorized these actions by general actions, and then ones that pertain specifically to threats that climate change poses to our community. So actions for drought and water quality, flood and erosion, actions that would be for adaptation for plants and animals, transportation, energy, wildfire, and extreme heat. And so I'm just going to present to you some of those actions that are in the plan that are related to mitigation. They're They're less about response. But it is a range of actions that deal with, you know, hardening our systems, public education and outreach. But what I want to do today is introduce these actions to you, not to say these should be in the plan, but these are the types of actions we may want to consider that we as a group, as communities, want to memorialize in the mitigation plan, because important work was done by the adaptation plan, and they are relevant to improving resiliency in our community. So there were 18 general actions in the Thurston Climate Adaptation Plan. I'm just going to show you two of these. So Brandon, as you talked about that ongoing public outreach, this one, G11, might fit into that. So this is creating a website that details health risks exacerbated by climate change and provides information that helps residents prepare for and respond to drought or air quality, extreme heat, disease vectors, and other threats. So this would probably be a separate mapping tool or website from the tool you identified, Brandon, but the type of information it would provide and the benefit it could serve to residents is similar. And in the adaptation plan, Thurston County Public Health was identified as the lead for this strategy. But we do have wildfire, we do have smoke coming from British Columbia and elsewhere in the Pacific Northwest that impacts our air quality. We have had increasingly warmer summers. June 21 with the heat dome is a perfect example of something that is so rare and out of the norm that having information that could have provided some assistance to those who are vulnerable and need could have been helpful. In fact, possibly could have even saved lives. Next one, G17, advocating for expanding the eligibility of federal disaster assistance funding to allow for the replacement or relocation of aging or vulnerable infrastructure before it fails. So this is more of educating our legislators about the value in needing additional resources and federal disaster assistance or federal mitigation funds to be a bit more flexible in serving our community's needs. There's a bunch of them here for flood, erosion, climate adaptation actions. Everything that covers from how do we restore riparian areas and protect natural functions to reduce erosion from excess or extreme rainfall events to maintain water quality and protect habitat, all the way down to protecting historical or cultural sites that are at risk of coastal or inland flooding, erosion, and wildfires. So taking a look at more of our social cultural assets and thinking about, hey, what's at risk, not because of just a flood event, but flood being exacerbated by warmer, wetter winters, and are we paying attention to that? So there's a whole number of them here. Any one of these would make sense, in my opinion, to include in a hazard mitigation plan, but just what you would think would be appropriate to carry over and continue in this plan update. And then a number of them in the wildfire and extreme heat category, there's some overlap between what was in the mitigation plan, because the climate adaptation plan was actually referencing the previous version of the hazard mitigation plan as it was developed. So that's why you see create and maintain a map of the region's high-risk wildland urban interface communities. So while DNR has done some work, that data is informed by analysts looking over maps, crunching numbers, doing data to say, yep, this area has the types of characteristics that would make it vulnerable to wildfire. But perhaps what might be missing to that is empirical information, knowledge from fire chiefs and personnel who've been directly involved in areas that have been impacted by wildfires or are suspected of being impacted, and really calling those out and getting those mapped in our community. So maybe there's still some more work that needs to be done there. But in principle, mapping the WUI has been accomplished. And then there's some regulatory recommendations in here, like requiring new developments in like a WUI or a intermix to submit a fire protection plan during site review. So this would be that if a prospective developer was working with the city or say Thurston County Community Planning Economic Development, the county could look at the map with the WUI and say, okay, this area is at risk. You need to consult with West Thurston Regional Fire Authority on what mitigation steps you're taking to reduce fuels around the development and make sure that future construction and the landscaping is safeguarded and protected from wildland fires. let me see what else is in here. Yeah, enhancing training and financial support for wildfire response. So maybe our fire service partners would like, you know, have more personnel coming on board, need more training. Are there resources to do that? So this is just showing you an example of the types of climate adaptation actions that have a nexus with mitigation in our community. So I'm just gonna stop here and see what questions you might have and just have a discussion about what you think should be walked into the mitigation plan and a step for doing this. Because there's 91 actions, but not all 91 of those actions warrant inclusion in the mitigation plan. I guess my question would be, what's a good way for us to comb through these as well as consider new actions that haven't been identified for inclusion in our plan update? I'll just say one opportunity is we still have some of our climate adaptation plan staff around, so we could get the band back together to help us assess what has been done and help identify what some of those priorities are and bring those priorities back to you. Also, several of the communities have identified climate mitigation and sustainability staff who could also be providing feedback that could provide some subject matter expertise on climate adaptation. Anybody have anything to share? Did you learn anything? I can start putting folks on the spot too. I'm gonna ask Emily Bergkamp from Inner City Transit, what types of climate adaptation strategies would be relevant to IT that you might be considering including in your annex? If you've given that any thought.
Absolutely. Hi, Paul. Sorry, I'm a little below my camera view there. But currently, Inner City Transit is working with a consultant firm to see about our transition to zero emissions technology. For us, we are considering several different options, including but not limited to hydrogen fuel cell buses, as well as battery electric buses as well. Also looking at other ways to leverage our current fuel system, including our renewable diesel, to make continuous steps towards more sustainability and lower emissions as an agency, even with what we're doing right now. But we're very excited to be considering what might work best for us. And sometimes each transit agency has to make that decision based on the unique dynamics of their service area. But that's something that we're undergoing right now to contribute to lowering emissions and just overall climate issues in our community.
And Emily, I don't mean to put you on the spot, but I'm going to put you on the spot one more time. Because you're always a good candidate, willing to take one for the team here. So in addition to like mitigating or reducing greenhouse gas emissions to fight further impacts to climate change, has inner city transit had any conversations about how the impacts of climate change are going to affect your service in terms of hazards or flooding or anything like that? Just
Our location downtown, we know not only is going to be affected, the Olympia Transit Center, by tidal flooding, but also liquefaction and things like that, but specifically in regards to climate change. The new facility is following updated codes to make sure that the groundwork, or I guess the framework of that the building is built on, meets those requirements, so that we're not sitting underwater, we're sitting above water when those things happen. But other things, just to show kind of the march of time, even through the procurement of buses, you know, when I started, we did not have air conditioning on all of our buses, and now we do. And that's strictly because we've seen over time that we can't just open all the windows and expect everybody to be comfortable on our buses. So even items like that contribute for sure. So those are just a couple small examples that I would provide, but I'm certainly open to any questions about anything else. So,
No, those are great, Emily. And it just reminds me, so when you're developing your annexes, this applies to everybody. One of the areas that FEMA requires a jurisdiction to review is your development trends. And inner city transit's done some significant development since 2017 with the construction of the downtown Olympia Transit administrative office, as well as your new maintenance operations admin building on Martin Way. And so it would be helpful, as you just described, to state what new construction has happened and what steps inner city transit has done to mitigate those potential hazards and make it more resilient. So that would be very helpful to just make sure you're mentioning that. Mike, what about Olympia's sea level rise strategy? Maybe you and Susan could both talk a little bit about that.
Sure, I'd be happy to take a first step into it, and Susan, feel free to back me up. One thing is the city's invested in starting an entire program to look at sea level rise and prepare for the effects of that. Dr. Pamela Braff is leading that. And one of the things that we've looked at a policy level is anytime we bring something forward to council that needs to be voted on, whether it's a contract or a purchase or new language in the OMC, anything like that, is we have to do a section on the impacts to the environment and how whatever policy issue we're bringing forward, how that has been considered and steps taken to mitigate that. There's probably much more work that's happening, but those are just some large level kind of investments the city has made to prepare for this as we move forward. Anything you'd like to add, Susan?
The only thing I was thinking about adding is the fact that the stormwater utility has put in its tide gates on all of our outfalls, all of our stormwater outfalls. That was something that was written into the Olympia Sea Level Rise Response Plan, and we've done that. And it was one of the mitigation measures, Paul, you had on a earlier slide.
Yeah, on the flood and erosion one, I think it was listed there.
Yeah, and that sounds right.
And so Susan, again, that would be a good one, like a case study or something to highlight in your annex as steps that Olympia has taken to reduce those combined sewer outflows and protect water quality. But let me pose the question, is the Olympia Lot Clean Water Alliance, Port of Olympia sea level rise strategy warrant some mention in the mitigation plan as some, is there some type of countywide mitigation or, and clearly it's not gonna affect South Thurston County, but it does impact other stakeholders like inner city transit, other providers in the community that warrant some other coordination beyond the partners to the sea level rise response strategy.
Paul, when you were going over the mitigation measures, the countywide, that's exactly what I was thinking, but not 100% understanding yet exactly what a Thurston countywide mitigation strategy might be, but I was thinking any way we can get support, and we being Olympia Lot and the Port of Olympia, any support we can get for sea level rise response, absolutely.
I would believe it.
Oh, go ahead, Mike.
Oh, I'm sorry, Susan. I'm going to go ahead and finish. I'll go after you.
Oh, all I was thinking is, remember, of course, LOT does stand for Lacey, Olympia, Tumwater, and Thurston County. And if we have sewer problems, so will those jurisdictions. It's not just Olympia.
And also, the sea level mitigation plan, sea level rise mitigation plan, and it's being updated now. I would believe that the work that Pamela does, that she would coordinate that with the stakeholders that would be affected or could support the plan. But I don't have the view of that in my position right now.
And that would be a good conversation to have with Pamela about, you know, what needs to be in Olympia's plan, but is there something in the region-wide mitigation plan that warrants additional recognition or memorialization somehow, something that rises above your immediate partners. So if that makes sense, if what I'm saying makes sense there. Yeah,
I think it makes sense. And I'd just like to point out, it's not just the City of Olympia. There's a new coalition that was put together. So it does include all of the partners. So I think it's a question for that group as opposed to just the City of Olympia.
Fair. Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Susan. I see that Amy Towsley from Puget Sound Energy is on board with us. And so, Amy, I'm going to put you on the spot, if you may. So thinking about climate adaptation, and I'm thinking about like Southwest Thurston County, maybe even Southeast Thurston County, where we do have a lot of fuels. And with overhead power lines, is in terms of a wildfire strategy for reducing power disruptions, is that something that Puget Sound Energy as a private stakeholder has some role in our public mitigation strategy?
Am I coming through, Paul? Can you hear me? I just want to make sure.
I can hear you. Yeah.
All right. Great. Good afternoon, everybody. Yeah, I've been furiously taking notes. You know, some of it was some of the mapping that Casey went through. Some of those utility corridors, you know, especially the transmission system. And it's not hard to find overhead lines, you just look up. But so I think some of the mapping might be really helpful to the jurisdictions. It might already be in their comp plan. The Thurston County comp plan has a map that I've known for almost 20 years now, you know, identifying those overhead facilities. I really appreciated the comment you made about kind of the security issues. You know, we've had substations shot at and right there in Tumwater. So I think I really appreciate your comments about security and sharing the data as we work with law enforcement on that aspect. And again, with our regulatory agencies. So Paul, I think it would be helpful to, if the jurisdictions don't know where all the substations are, it might be in their comp plan map, as I said earlier. It's certainly in Olympia's comp plan map. I remember that. So. I think then also other facilities are how the system, again, kind of that integration here in Thurston County. Again, we're connected with Pierce and our other adjacent utilities as well. So, and then I think some of that mapping that is already in some of the other facilities would be certainly, you know, with reference to natural gas, you know, the Williams pipeline where Puget takes off from that. So some of that's already in existence. One of the notes, if I could just add one more thing is, you know, there's been this thread for almost 15 years of regional planning, you know, the sustainability plan, the adaptation plan of 2018, the mitigation plan of just, you know, just a year ago or so. And then how these all weave in with the hazard mitigation plans and the comp plan updates. So I definitely want to talk more with not just the Thurston Council, but the individual jurisdictions and how we're related to you know, kind of meeting those goals, wildland fire, transportation system corridors are usually where the electric systems are. You know, we're in the right of way a lot more than we are across country, but that's important to bring up. So there's a whole bunch of notes, Paul, and I'd love to talk to you more.
Yeah, let's do that, Amy. And I made note about the utilities lines. I think we did the county's utilities map for their comp plan and some other jurisdictions. So we do have some of those, those transmission lines that Casey and I can talk about, maybe looking at adding those to the map as an additional layer.
Yeah, or referring to where they may already exist. I think for, you know, from part of our implementation at Puget is where we've switched out the conductor along heavily treed corridors, Eld Inlet for one. We put in tree wire, you know, how our system is really adapted to really resiliency over the last 10 to 15 years and beyond, you know, where we're headed with some of those capital improvements. You know, we do the same thing, we're pipe and wire. So how we're trying to meet those challenges and the goals under CETA and a whole list of other acronyms. So definitely we want to be very engaged and we're happy to help. And I could certainly bring in our subject matter experts as we have on some of the other stuff, the climate. So thanks, Paul.
Yeah, thank you, Amy. I'm glad you joined us today. And it's nice to have a key stakeholder like PSE in our meeting. So appreciate that. I'm going to put one last person on the spot. Who am I going to pick? I'm going to go with Kim Gooby from Thurston PUD, just thinking about climate adaptation because you manage so many water systems throughout Thurston County. So your customers are reliant on the delivery of fresh water. So what thoughts has the PUD given to being able to maintain a sustainable water supply in the face of climate impacts and risk for wildfires, things like that? Have you given any thought to mitigation or adaptation strategies there?
Mostly what the PUD is looking at now is, again, keeping our customers in water during, after emergencies and power outages. Again, we have a great relationship with PSE. Amy does a great job with emergency response, and we communicate after an emergency to try to get our customers back in water. But a step beyond that is generators. Currently, we're working on getting backup generators. We have a FEMA grant for one of our water systems, and then also getting trailers or generators on trailers so we can move them around to our water systems. We already mitigate for wildfire. We try to, you know, keep our the landscaping down and making sure that our buildings are safe and have a wide berth. But really, we're working on that generator and keeping them in water. We're also working on seismic valves on all of our reservoirs at this time, so that what after an earthquake, we would be able to sustain that water in the reservoir and then be able to make it available to the community.
Thanks, Kim.
Mm-hmm.
Anybody else get inspired by the conversation, have something that they would like to join that their jurisdiction is doing? Brandon, I see your hand is up.
Well, it's not something the jurisdiction's currently doing, but just something that I saw that I guess piqued my curiosity to look further into is in the climate adaptation plan talking about revising permitting or building code ordinances for new development in, I guess, high risk wildfire areas. So one, I mean, I guess it just goes in line with trying to work to develop what that authoritative data for wildland fire risk looks like and get it kind of to enough fidelity to where we could actually tie it to a regulatory requirement. And then from there, it seems like at least at the county level, we already have a mechanism through our critical areas ordinance to do development regulation and permitting requirements for new developments based on natural hazard risk and just incorporating wildfire into that. And I know the National Fire Protection Association already has standards and recommendations for structural protection that could be referenced. And so it's definitely something that's worth exploring, I think, for, you know, Thurston County, as well as the other jurisdictions that have some interface air mix, which I believe is everybody. So.
Yeah, there was legislation in 2018 and Gross Senate Substitute Bill 6109, I believe, which is what funded DNR's mapping of the WUI and now requires jurisdictions, if they haven't done so already, to be looking at adopting the International WUI Building Code. So I know that that's something in the works, so it'd be worth talking to your building officials about your jurisdiction's efforts pertaining to that. Okay, well, thank you everybody for the discussion on that one. What I'm trying to do is inspire you to think about, one, what are the types of initiatives that we should be working on collectively, because there's a multi-jurisdictional benefit, and two, what types of actions are appropriate for your jurisdiction to take, as well as countywide, that would help with climate adaptation or mitigating effects we are forecast to experience here in Thurston County in the decades ahead. So more to come on that. So lastly, I just wanted to give you an overview before we adjourn, an overview of what's coming with our schedule. So let me get my screen share going here. So I just kind of want to give you a big picture overview of where we're at through this chart and where we would like to go. I feel like we're already stressed for time on this. One thing is we were hoping to have that critical infrastructure risk assessment portion out at this meeting, but that's going to get pushed out to our March meeting. So for March 27th at our next meeting, the agenda will have two major components to that. And one is an overview of the critical facility results from the risk assessment from Tetra Tech. And then before we meet, TRPC in partnership with Tetra Tech will be sending out a questionnaire or a survey, what we're calling a SWU. It's strengths, weaknesses, obstacles, and opportunities, where you and your mitigation planning teammates in your jurisdiction will kind of just do a simple assessment of whether something is a strength or a weakness to a series of questions. We'll compile those results and bring it back. And based on those results, we will be looking at what build off this discussion about mitigation strategy development, both on the countywide side and informing your local mitigation strategy. And so that's what's the bulk for March. Between now and that meeting, Casey and I want to get out to you templates for your annexes that pertain to the risk assessment, getting feedback from you on those jurisdiction hazard maps that we're going to send out a link to the box account so you can download those. And then working March into April, looking at starting to formalize or finalize, I should say, what are those countywide mitigation actions we want to include, we're proposing to include in our draft plan update. And then also starting in April, looking at developing our public outreach strategy as it pertains to our risk assessment and the plan recommendations. Because our hope is that by May, we are going out for a public outreach strategy to have some type of public facing online story map that characterizes what our community risks to the hazards are that we're profiling in the plan and the types of actions we're proposing to respond to mitigating those hazards. That will be, you know, the story map will be more of the viewer, the information, the background tool, and then having some companion survey that asks questions about the characterization of the risk and the appropriateness of our actions to respond to those risks. That leads up to starting to compile and format and have a draft plan ready by the end of May to then be responsive to the public feedback from that survey. Our objective here at TRPC, I think there's a little bit of wiggle room, but what we would like to do is have a plan submitted to Washington Emergency Management Division, that core plan for review by the end of June. They have 30 days to review, barring any missing planning requirements that the state hazard mitigation strategist might require us to revisit and fulfill. Our plan would be bumped up to FEMA. They have a 45-day regulatory review window to get us the plan. So that means we're looking at having ideally a plan back from FEMA by early September that would, for those jurisdictions who have annexes ready that submitted with our core plan, a status of approval pending adoption, meaning that it's then up to you as leads to get those plans before your legislative bodies, your city councils, your commissions, your boards for review, first reading, however, whatever your process is, ultimately adoption, so that you have some evidence of adoption, whether that's the form of a resolution or your meeting minutes to resubmit to FEMA. With that, a plan approval letter is submitted and we should be golden for another 5 years to apply for mitigation grants and do continuing public outreach on what our communities are doing collectively to reduce risks in the communities. So I'm gonna pause there and see if there's any questions about the schedule, and I'll do my best to answer them.
Paul? This is Susan Clark with Olympia. I do have a question. Towards the end of the schedule, I thought I heard you say something about the annexes. When do we have to have our annex done? Does it get reviewed by FEMA as well?
Yeah, so I would like annex development where as much as possible. This isn't a requirement. Let me back up and say FEMA's review guidelines and the states for annexes is a participating jurisdiction to a regional mitigation planning process has up to 1 year to complete and have the plan reviewed by state and FEMA and adopted to be approved by FEMA as part of that plan development. And historically, of the planning processes I've been through, we have a handful of front runners at the beginning, at the process when we submit our core plan for review. It's usually the county. It's often been like Inner City Transit, Olympia, Lacey, Tumwater that are there with an annex ready for review at the same time our plan is going forward. I don't want to submit our core plan for review unless I have at least one annex ready to go with it. There's no, we can get a preview on our core plan, but the clock isn't going to start ticking until an actual affected jurisdiction has a plan reviewed. So ideally, we would want some subset of annexes ready to go by the end of June with the core plan for review. And it's
looks like there's a annex template that'll be coming. So is that a fairly light lift for jurisdictions to do their annex when you consider the template and previous work that has been done? I just new to me, so I thought I'd just ask that.
We're doing a lot of the lifting for you. That annex template comes with a checklist of things you have to do at the local level. It depends on how deep you want to go, but there are extra steps that the cities and the county have to do with, say, documenting your participation in the National Flood Insurance Program. So you would want to bring whoever your lead is on NFIP to be addressing those parts of the plan. So I don't think the lift is burdensome, but it will require some work and some coordination among your team members. You also, Olympia, as an example, you have a mitigation plan and annex. So you're mostly updating that and refreshing it, but accounting for two things that are important. Three things you really need to hit with this annex. And we're gonna talk more about this, but three things that the new FEMA policy guidance wants to see included in plan updates is, one, how you're accounting for the effects of climate change in your hazard mitigation risk assessment and mitigation strategy. And so for Olympia, because of all the work you've done with sea level rise response, I don't see that being an issue. The other thing you need to do is account for how your mitigation strategy and risk is accounting for socially vulnerable populations. And then lastly, how are you accounting for changes in development or development patterns? Those are the three things that FEMA that are new that they'll be paying attention to. And then the other thing that hangs up annexes that I see is jurisdictions not adequately speaking to how you will continuously engage the public after your plan is adopted. You need to have some way of continuing to engage the community, whether it's through a website, social media, doing announcements at city council meetings, holding workshops, et cetera. You need to have some strategy for that. And yes, those will all be listed because FEMA has a really nice plan checklist that you can reference. And so the idea here is TRPC develops the annex, develops the core plan, provides you guidance on the annex. You develop the annexes, and before we even submit the annexes to the state, TRPC looks through it. TRPC will provide guidance on your annex as to, hey, you're strong in this area, you should be good to go, or we would recommend a little more work. And if we don't know the answer, we'll reach out to the state hazard mitigation strategist for some consultation before we even submit your plan for review, because we want you to succeed in your plan going through both the state and FEMA.
Thanks so much for the support.
Okay, any other questions? Casey, any last minute things to add?
Nope.
Okay, so nope. I can stay online for a few minutes later if anyone wants to stay online and ask questions. Other than that, we are adjourned. Thank you for everybody showing up today and have a great day.